Open your Bibles. I'll start the timer on communion day. That's to make sure we get done on time. Title of the message this morning, Growing in the Holy Spirit, Part 3. I'm sorry. It's, you know, the video guys asked me, you know, why the new background? I said, bro, that's not a new background. It's a series. I didn't know we were in a series. I didn't know we were in a series either. So we're all in it together. This is part 3, the final message, subtitle, Praying the Psalms. Praying the Psalms, so important. This impromptu little mini-series started with our last message in the 1 Year with Jesus series. That message was called Don't Go Without the Holy Spirit. Do you remember it? It was, 4 weeks ago, and we looked at Acts chapter 1. And so I wanted to take the opportunity to share more with you about your dire need to understand the role of the Holy Spirit in your life. It's crucial. It's crucial. Listen, if you're saved, the devil can't stop you from going to heaven, but he can stop you from having any power, any peace, any usefulness for the kingdom of God. And you can just under your breath say amen if you've ever met a Christian that doesn't seem to have any usefulness for the kingdom of God. You need the Holy Spirit to have a usefulness for the kingdom of God. You need his power, you need his peace, you need his transforming power. So I jumped in and we did 2 messages called Growing in the Holy Spirit. And so I figured let's wrap it up today with a third one, part 3. Let me say one other thing. On the screen is the Fundamentals series. The Fundamentals series kind of does the same thing. So I'd really encourage you if you're like, well, I'm not really sure what to do about all this Holy Spirit talk. There it is on the screen. Get that series on the phone app. Search Word by Mail in your app store or on the wordbymail.com website. Listen to at least the first 4 messages of the Fundamentals series. They're all about what we're talking about today. Quiet time, meditating on God's word, praying according to God's word, and worshiping according to God's word. So that's kind of the place that we're at right now with this. As we've talked about growing in the Holy Spirit, we've made it clear that our being empowered by the Holy Spirit, our being led by the Holy Spirit, our being influenced by the Holy Spirit is always according to God's word. You heard me right? Always according to God's word. The Holy Spirit will influence you. If you will develop a sensitivity to him, he'll influence you. He will lead you, he will empower you, and he will always do it according to God's word. Here's the problem, is that most Christians don't take the time to figure out how to do that. We may know intellectually, we may know theologically, yeah, that's the Holy Spirit's job, is to influence me, to lead and guide me, lead me into all truth, and to empower me, but how? I don't know how. I just go to church, and then I go home and watch, you know, Super Bowl, whatever, and I don't know how. So today, we're going to do this incredible practical message on how to actually pray the Psalms. Now, these practical messages, the kind of technical messages, they're kind of like Volkswagens. When we were young, Volkswagens, you either hate them or you love them, right? The people who have Volkswagens, like Tom, love them. If you didn't have one, you hated it. And if you're a practical person, you're going to love this. If you're not a practical person, you're going to go, what? And I'm sorry, just hang in there with me. Learn how to be influenced and led and empowered by the Holy Spirit. It's crucial for your walk with Jesus, all right? Okay, let's pray. Lord Jesus, please, Lord, reveal to us that going to church isn't going to transform our lives. That being in a real, vital, living relationship with you will transform our lives. It's you in us. It's not us in church. It's you in us that transforms our lives. And so, Lord, we pray that you would show us today how. Give us the practical steps. At least, Lord, give us an idea of what we need to commit to bring you into the center of our lives and allow you to supernaturally transform us, Lord. Show us those practical steps today, we pray in your name, Jesus, amen. Prayer is our communion with God, right? You know that. It is it's the outgrowth of our relationship with God. Here's how it works. Before the fall, Adam and Eve had full communion with God. They interacted, they interrelated, they had a two-way relationship with the Lord. The fall severed that relationship and separated Adam and Eve from God. Jesus Christ restored that relationship. He restored spiritually the relationship that Adam and Eve had prior to the fall. So now you can again commune with God spiritually in the way that Adam and Eve did. Prayer is how you do that. Prayer is how you do that. Prayer is that walking in the garden in the cool of the day with God. It's that place that we go where we interact with God, where we hear from him and where we speak to him, where we sense his leading and we feel his hand upon us. That's prayer. The most powerful way to do that is in God's word, is according to God's word. We're not talking about, coming up with our own stuff. You know, Jeremiah says, your heart is deceitfully wicked and who can know it? And so I say, don't trust it. Instead, trust God's word. And if we will learn to have that communion with God in his word and according to his word, it's the most powerful source of that life, that interactive relational life that we can have right in God's word. Right? Right. The Holy Spirit will align our hearts with the heart of God. And the Holy Spirit will align our wills with the will of God. If we will set ourselves to that, Remember, prayer is not to get your will accomplished in heaven. Prayer is to get God's will accomplished in you. And so we have to be willing to approach God naked and open and honest and transparent and say, God, I'm just here to walk with you in the cool of the day, to talk with you, to hear you talk to me. We have to desire that type of a relationship, and that relationship is transforming. Here's the good news. God has put a massive prayer and worship manual right in the center of the Bible. Almost. Isaiah 53 is actually the center, but right near the center of the Bible, God stuffs this massive, massive prayer and worship manual. For 3,000 years, God's people have learned how to pray and worship in the manual that God gave them. This is the book of Psalms. It's the most powerful book on prayer and worship you can buy. And believe me, there are thousands of them out there. And people's Bibles are dusty on the shelf and they're reading the next latest and greatest thing because that's what the Christian, promotional machine has told them to read. But God's like, hey, I got one. And you already own it. You probably own three of them. Let's look at it. The book of Psalms is the pure worship and power book, the pure prayer and worship power book. It's the song book and the prayer book of God's people, has always been, and it teaches us how to pray and how to worship. One of the early church fathers, I tried to pronounce his name, couldn't figure it out, so I'll just say one of the early church fathers, said, other scriptures speak to us, listen carefully, but the Psalms speak for us. They teach us how to speak to God. Another commentator, a current day commentator, said, we only pray well, listen carefully here, please. We only pray well when we are answering God in our prayer. The only time we're really praying well is when we're praying in response to God, in response to that interactive relationship we have with God. But we can only answer God if we know what God is saying to us, right? Right? We can only answer him if we know what he's saying. Here's the deal, okay? First, it's Lord, speak, and then my heart will respond, right? We don't get the lead in this conversation. God speaks first, and then we respond to him. Dr. Timothy Keller, who's an extremely well-respected pastor and scholar, says this. It's a long read. It's on the screen. Listen carefully. He says, the Psalms are the divinely ordained way to learn devotion to our God. They're the manual. There is no other place where you have an entire course of theology in prayer form. And no other place where you have, here's this is important, where you have every possible heart condition represented, along with the way to process that situation before God. I know that's a really long quote, but man, it says it all. The Psalms are the divinely ordained way to learn to pray. I don't know how to pray. All I do is repeat the prayer they taught me when I was a kid. Well, stop it. Stop it. Because the Psalms is a really, really big book. And if God wanted you to repeat a prayer, including the Lord's Prayer, by the way, he would have given you one to repeat. He wants communion with you. He wants interaction with you. And he shoved this huge book written over 600 to 800 years, put it right in the center of your Bible to teach you how to pray and how to worship. Man, it's a big deal. So here's the deal. I can't really teach you about the book of Psalms and teach you how to pray the Psalms in the same message. So I either got to do another message, which it will never end if I do that, or I have to encourage you to learn about the Psalms yourself. That's better. You, this country we live in, this culture we live in, is saturated with Christian resource reference material. I mean saturated. Get one and learn about the book of Psalms. Just set yourself to that and say, you know what? I gotta figure this out. The Psalms always been kind of, okay, well, those are Psalms. Let's move on. Don't do that. It's the manual to teach you how to interact, how to commune with God in prayer and in worship. So would you do that? Just make a note. Dave doesn't have time to teach it. So I have to go out and figure out how to learn about the book of Psalms. So you'll be like, wow, that's really cool. It's really cool. It's especially cool when you see the five books of the Psalms and how they match the first five books of the Bible and how they're connected to what we call the Pentateuch, that section of the Torah that Moses wrote, the first five books. But I can't go into it. You have to do it later. Just say okay to appease me. All right, thank you. All right, let's dive in. Here's how I started. I started saying, well, how do you do it? Somebody taught me, and it's a long time ago. And so maybe over the years, I guess it's developed, but I started writing down yesterday how I pray the Psalms. And I came up with a very simple 7-step process. that's a good one, Dave. I did 7 steps. And so when I got to 7 steps, I thought, all right, I have to give this to them in writing. I have to give this to them so they can fold it in half and put it in their Bible and refer back to it. So that's what you have in your hands. For those listening or watching later, it's called Praying the Psalms. It looks like this without the scribbles on it. And you can get one, I guess I should have thought this through, huh? You can get one on, we'll make a way to get it on both websites, on wordbymail.com and at the Calvary Chapel Nueva website. We'll make a way to get this. You should get it along with the Daily Discipleship Journal that we talked about, I think week before last. Those two pieces of paper, man, and you can save a bunch of money buying the latest and greatest books. So you have that with you. That is my personal 7-step process, adjusted a little bit for a general population. But here's the good news. It's really only four steps of reading and meditation and communion with God. The interactive part with God is really only four steps, but there are three preparation steps. You have to get, listen, God is ready to do something in your life. He's not busy. He's not involved in something else. He's ready. He's ready to transform your life. You have to get ready to be transformed. And so every time we approach God, we have to first prepare ourselves to be in that environment, that relational place with God. And so three of the steps are preparation steps. And then there are four steps of actual interaction with God. You ready to do it? Let's do it quickly. Number one, make a time and a place. I don't know if this is it's not the most important, but it is the prerequisite. If you don't have a time and a place, this doesn't really work. Like, you can't really do this in the shower, all right? The Bible gets all wet. You can't really write in there. You gotta make a time and a place. You gotta sit down where you can open up some stuff and say, okay, this is my place. This is my time, this is my place. The handout, I guess I'll call it a handout, says make a time and place to meet with the Lord in such a way that his word and his spirit will noticeably transform your life. Man, that is, for me, that's foundational about quiet time. It's not, did I burn through the Bible reading today while I was reading Fox News on my phone at the same time? It's not accomplishing a task. It's, are we being noticeably transformed from the relational time that we're spending with Jesus Christ? Does it leave a mark on us? If you are really going one-to-one, face-to-face, belly-to-belly, with the creator of the universe, it ought to leave a mark on you, right? You ought to be able to say, yeah, that impacted me. I met with God and it left a mark. That's the goal, is to be noticeably transformed. Psalm 62, King David makes this commitment perfectly clear. You could write that in a little handout. I kind of spread out the steps so you could write. King David says in Psalm 62, 1, I wait quietly before God. I make a place to meet God, and then I just be quiet. I wait quietly before God, for my victory comes from him. My victory comes from God. The ESV for Psalm 62:1 says, for God alone my soul waits. It's a great worship song, hard to do without drums, but one of my favorites. For God alone my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation, the ESV says. We've got to learn to wait quietly. We don't wait on anything, all right? We don't wait on anything. If I pause too long, you'll like get up and leave. Like, oh, I'm not waiting for him. You know, Chuck Smith, now he waited, all right? You had to learn to wait to listen to him. But I try to talk fast because I know that, you know, that we don't wait. We need to learn to wait on God. You gotta wait. Lord, I'm here. You said seek your face. I'm seeking your face. I'm in your presence. I'm waiting. We have to learn what it says, what the psalmist says in Psalm 46:10, when he says, be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that he is God. Lord, I need to make a time and a place where I am still and I know that you are God. You are God. Not me, not my stuff, not my plans, not my ideas. You. You and you alone are God. That's foundational. You got to get to that place on a regular basis. Make the time, make the place to get there, because that's where you meet God. That's where you talk to him. That's where you walk in the cool of the day in the garden with him, right? What's that old hymn about walking in the garden? Oh, man, I should have gone to some more hymn churches. Yeah. I walked in the garden alone with my Savior, is it? I don't remember. Yeah, Michael will know it. Yeah, he walked and he walks with me and he talks with me, right? Listen, you need that. You need that. You have to find a way to have some of that in your life. That's it. Start with making a time and a place. Number two, ask God to fill you with His Spirit and speak to you in His Word. You have to tell yourself why you're there. Lord, as I come into this place with you, would you fill me with your Spirit? Remember, we talked, I believe, two messages ago about being constantly filled with the Holy Spirit. Lord, fill me with your Spirit because I'm about to walk into this spiritual place, this supernatural place, and my flesh does no good there. So fill me with your Spirit and speak to me. Speak to me in your Word. Impress something eternal on my life as I sit down and talk with you, as I walk with you. God is ready to speak, the handout says. The question is, are you ready to listen? Take a moment to set your mind and your heart on hearing God speak. We've already said in this little mini-series, Jesus said in John 16, 13, he says, when the Spirit of truth comes, here's what he'll do. He will, one, he will guide you into all truth. He will guide you if you let him. Number two, he will not speak on his own, but he will tell you what he has heard. He will communicate God to you. And number three, verse 14, he will bring me glory. He will bring Jesus glory by telling you what he receives from me, Jesus said. That's the Holy Spirit's role. Holy Spirit, your role is to guide me into all truth according to God's eternal word. Do that. Do that as I sit with you. And Holy Spirit, please communicate God's word to me. Make God's word what it is, living and active and powerful in my life. And then bring Christ glory. Glorify Jesus in my life through my time with you. That's the goal. That's the goal. It's not flipped around. It's all for him. And so we have to come with the right focus, right? Intent on the right thing from the start. And so we come into this time asking to be filled with the Spirit, asking God to speak to us, and knowing that it's the Holy Spirit's role. That's what Jesus said in John 16. It's the Holy Spirit's role to guide us into all truth. We need him for that. It's the Holy Spirit's role to communicate God and to glorify Christ. That's his big role, is to glorify Christ in our lives. It's a huge part of who you are in Christ, to be led into truth, to know God's word, to glorify Christ. These are all roles of the Holy Spirit. You have to get in a place where you are interacting with God in that power, in that leading, in that anointing of the Holy Spirit. He does that almost always, and at least primarily, according to God's word. And he will always do it according to God's word. I should say, he almost always does it through God's word, and he always does it according to God's word. God doesn't change. His word doesn't change. I'm sorry, but it doesn't. So we've got to approach prayer by saying, okay, Lord, I'm coming to be impacted by you. I'm coming to be changed by you. I'm coming to be transformed in your presence. So fill me with your Spirit, speak to me, and leave a mark on me before I leave this place. Right? All right, that's number two. Number three, this gets really practical, all right? I know this is like almost too practical, but it's important. The third step on your handout says, use a study Bible for context. Listen, please. You don't know what the Psalms are about. I mean, you read a Psalm and you just go, whoa, that's a little wild, right? It's pretty crazy. I mean, there's some Psalms that are just flat out like, wow, should that be in the Bible? I'll talk about those in a second. The big picture is you need a little guide. Here's why. Because the correct interpretation of Scripture is always based on the context it was originally written in. Now, that's kind of a college level statement. Not that I heard it in college, but it sounds like it should be. It sounds like something they should say. Correct interpretation, this is accurate. Okay, I just didn't happen to be in college when I learned it. Correct interpretation of the Bible is always based on the context that the scripture was originally written in, so you need to know it. You need to know, what was the psalmist feeling? What was he going through? Where was he in his life? Why did he write this? What do we have in the back for the background of this psalm before I jump into it? Because here's what happens. If you put it in context, then you will relate correctly to the psalm writer. So there's your study Bibles. There's a list of them. My newest favorite is called the Illustrated Study Bible. I meant to get some for you, and I probably will. They're a little pricey, but they're really cool. And then some of our old-time favorites, Life Application, of course, always wonderful. The Transformation Study Bible, edited by Warren Wiersbe, which is a wonderful study Bible. ESV and NLT Study Bibles we always have on the back for you. Phone app. Sign up for the Faith Life Study Bible on your phone so you never have an excuse to say, I don't have a study Bible with me, it's too big. Get it on your phone, man. Get the Faith Life Study Bible, sign up for it, it's good. I'll tell you more about Faith Life another day. Or get Kindle on your phone and just buy one of the study Bibles on Kindle. So you always have a study Bible on your phone, so when someone says, hey, what's that psalm about? You say, just give me a second. Oh, it's about this. For example, there are psalms that we call imprecatory. I glance at the word. Who uses this word? Imprecatory psalms. That's like, you know, imprecatory. This word imprecatory, now that I've said it some, it's kind of fun. This word imprecatory means to call down a curse upon someone. Don't tell me you haven't done it. To call down a curse, the judgment of God, to call down the judgment of God on someone that you see as an enemy. Okay, I've done that. Here's the deal. There is every emotion you will ever feel in life contained in the book of Psalms. Everything you will ever experience in life, a psalmist has experienced more than once. And so every life situation, just like Dr. Keller, Timothy Keller said earlier in the quote, every life situation you have is in the Psalms, and it teaches you how to respond to it. And so when you have a little study Bible, you can glance at it. I don't mean do a big old Bible study, just do a quick little glance. Most of the study Bibles have a short little paragraph for the beginning of each psalm that says, this is what was happening when this psalm was written, because there's background to the psalms. So if you just read that, you go, oh, okay, I get it. David's kind of upset because Saul's trying to kill him. Well, of course he's going to pray that. I'd pray it too. If Saul just threw a spear at me, you would too. So we understand that, but here's the deal with the imprecatory psalms that call down judgment of God's psalms. At the end, God always wins in the psalms. And if you read through that at the end, the psalmist goes, that's what I'd like, God, but your will, not mine. I know that judgment is yours. You'll repay. I know that you'll make it right. And so we get to that same point where in our emotion, we may cry out to God for his judgment upon someone we perceive as an enemy. But then in the end, we say, you know what, God? That is how I feel. And I know I can bring my heart to you just as I feel. But in the end, I choose to say, thy will be done. You know best, you take care of it. God does hate injustice, he does. And there is retribution for sin, and it is God's wrath. That's true. And so just let God handle it, all right? His wrath is worse than yours. You might not think so, but it is. And so a study Bible will help you kind of get a feel for what's going on. So just glance at it, and then here's the deal. Here's what I need you to hear. Put yourself in the psalmist's shoes. So if the psalmist is angry, then I don't mean you be angry, but you understand, okay, this is for when I'm angry. And if you're not angry at the time, maybe pick another psalm or remember when you were. But the psalm will help you to I don't want to say to allow yourself to enable you, but it allows you to experience all of the emotions in life. And so the study Bible kind of sets you up to do that. Moving on. Make a time and a place. Ask God to fill you with His Spirit and speak to you. Get something, a study Bible or something, to get a little context so you have a little background, and then you're ready to read. That's it. That's all the preparation. So now we're just ready to read. So if you get the other stuff handled, if you kind of live in that, now you can come to the Psalms and read. So step number four, read through the Psalm, finally. When you get an idea of the big picture, the context, read through the Psalm. Taking note, either mentally or physically, taking note of the truths that apply to your life just as they did to the psalmist. Here's the deal, all right? There's nothing new under the sun. We studied the fall of man in Genesis 3 last Wednesday, and everybody in the room said, yep, that's still how the devil does it to me. Yep, I'm still deceived the same way. I still fall into sin the same way Adam and Eve did. Nothing's changed. So what the psalmist felt, you feel. What the psalmist experienced, you experience. So when you're reading through it, ask yourself, is the psalmist grateful? Is he thankful? Is he fearful? Is he in suffering? Is he rejoicing? Is he repentant? Where is he? And then put yourself in his shoes. Put yourself right in the psalmist's shoes and say, okay, Lord, for the times when I'm this way, and I'm going to show you in a second how to kind of pick the psalms, but if he's rejoicing, let me rejoice. If he's feeling suffering, then let me experience that with you. Let me kind of step into his shoes, relate to him, and apply your word to my life in that area. Is that too complicated? It's not too complicated, right? Our goal is to apply what the psalmist experienced. Our goal is to apply to our life what the psalmist experienced in their life when they wrote the psalm. So on the first read, get the big picture. What's David going through? What's the psalmist going through? And is it just, but is it a song of praise? Is it just a hallel psalm, a hallelujah psalm, a song of ascents, just worship? There's a ton of just hardcore worship. There's very few worship songs today that aren't in some way connected to the Psalms. All right, you got it? That's the first read. And listen, if you read like Psalm 118 or something that's, like 6 pages long, don't do the whole Psalm. Break it into sections. Get a feel for what you can do and break it down and do a section in a day if you can't do the whole Psalm, and I seldom can personally. Number five, first you read through the psalm. You follow me in your handout? Don't just listen. Kind of make notes on that handout so you can keep it with you. Number five, meditate on a verse or section at a time. So now you've read through the psalm. Now comes in this crucial, life-changing word, meditate. Oh, did he say meditate? Yeah, I did. I said meditate. Meditate, slow down. Chew on the key verses. See the word mutter on your notes? Mutter. Think deeper than the word on the page. This is not the newspaper. Don't read it like the newspaper. Slow down. Chew on the key verses. Think deeper than the word on the page. Roll over in your mind the idea of the verse or the section. Let it sink in. There's a process to do that. The Bible calls it meditating. Hebrew word, haggah. Haggah. You can say that. Haggah. Now, you can't say all of them, but that one you can say. Haggah. It means literally to utter in a low sound. Right? Low talkers, right? Seinfeld, didn't they have an episode? Low talker, no, close talker. It was close talker, that's worse. Listen, meditate means literally to utter in a low sound, to make a verbal sound and to kind of repeat something over and over. If you go to Jerusalem with us, we're trying to pick the next trip. If you go with us and if you're polite and quiet, you get up close to the guys praying at the wall and they're daving like this and they're just repeating the prayers. And that's muttering. It's meditation, haggah. It's repeating something, chewing on it over and over. The best definition I've found for how it's used biblically is to think intently at length. In fact, some of the more modern translations replace the word meditate with think. And I don't know, I don't get the same feel for it, but meditating is thinking. Meditation biblically is not Eastern meditation, all right? Get that out of your mind. It's not Eastern meditation. Biblical meditation is thinking intently and at length. Just listen to those words. I should have put them on the screen. Thinking intently and at length. God, what is that? What are you saying to me? Holy Spirit, speak to me. What is this? Oh, you're kidding. Really? You have to bring that up? Now you're in a conversation with God. You know what I'm saying? It's not always like that, but there's some response where you set yourself on something and then God speaks to you through the Holy Spirit. So meditation is not clearing your mind in order to reach some kind of perfect nothingness. Biblical meditation means to think intently and at length. It means to talk in a low voice to ourselves and to God, to mutter, you know, Lord, what is it? What is it? What is this? What does this mean? You know, I don't understand. Love my enemies. That's foreign to me. Is there something else? Can I find that one that says crush my enemies? I mean, just, you know, you have a conversation. To meditate means to be completely occupied with the subject at hand. Immerse yourself. It's an intense focus, a deep consideration. The very first psalm, just real quickly, Psalm 1, which sets the stage for the entire book, it was placed there on purpose to set the stage, shows us what happens, the reward for meditating on God's word. Psalm 1, 1 through 3 says, "Oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers, but instead they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night." There it is right there. Delighting in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night, thinking intently and at length, uttering, muttering, repeating it over and over in your mind and your heart. Verse 3 says, here's the reward. "They are like trees planted along the riverbank, bearing fruit each season, their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do." What a wonderful kickoff for the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms is the meditation manual. I know, there's people like, oh, he said meditation, you know. Listen, I'm not talking about Eastern wackiness, all right? I'm talking about biblical meditation, man. Dig in, let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Amen? We have to learn to talk to God at length about a certain subject matter until it changes us, until we're convinced that God's right and we are wrong. That's the goal. All right, so again, there's three preparation steps, and we read through the psalm. We kind of know where the psalmist is at. We're reading through the psalm. We're kind of putting ourselves in his shoes, and then we're meditating on a certain section, a certain verse, something that the Holy Spirit leads us to. We're really sinking in there, and then step 6, see, we're already on step 6, be sensitive to what the Holy Spirit is impressing on you. Open yourself up, and I don't mean to the mystic thing. I mean to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, what is it? Speak. Where did God speak? What is it in this psalm that you're speaking to me? I want to hear what you're saying. I want you to impress the living and powerful and life-changing word of God on my life. Your notes, again, just for formality, say, listen to what the Holy Spirit is pointing out to you. Ask God to reveal how these timeless truths specifically apply to your life today. Be honest and transparent with God. Be sensitive to what the Holy Spirit is impressing on you. That whole step comes from Hebrews 4, 12 and 13, one of my very favorite verses. It says, "For the word of God is living, is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires if we will follow verse 13, nothing in all creation is hidden from God. I mean, that's true whether you're trying to hide or not. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes, and he is the one to whom we are accountable. If you've been here a while, you've heard me quote these verses 100 times because that's where we need to get, where the word of God is being what it is, living and powerful and active in our lives, a discerner of the thoughts and intents of our hearts, exposing our innermost thoughts and us recognizing, Lord, you might be the only one, but you alone know everything about me, everything. And you might want to add, and you love me anyway. But Lord, there's nothing I can hide from you. And so I come as I am, naked and open, transparent to the eyes of the only one to whom I'll give account. So speak to me. Draw something out and make it real in my heart. Lord, pierce me, strengthen me, reconcile, restore, revive, heal, break. Whatever it is, God, do something. What are you saying to me in this psalm? James 1:19, I'm guessing. You can check or not. But somewhere around there says, be quick to hear and slow to speak. Don't run into God's presence. Am I right? Okay. Don't run into God's presence saying, okay, God, I only got a minute. I just wanted to shoot you my grocery list, pal, so you can get to work on it. And listen, were you off yesterday? Because, you know, all right, I'll just tell you what it is again today so you can get to it. Zip it, man. Zip it. Zip it. Let him talk first. He's God. He's really big, and he ought to get to talk first. So you come to him and you say, okay, Lord, I'm here, and I'm going to respond to you. You're going to say something to me, and I'm going to respond back to you. Now, that may be a little nerve-wracking for some of us. We're like, hey, we just want to go to church so we can get the heaven thing checked off, so we can get there when we die. That's not what it's about. God wants a real, honest relationship with you. You have to seek that. So you go into it with that commitment, and then don't move. Don't leave. Don't leave. Say, God, I'm going to sit here until you speak to me. I'm going to sit here and meditate on this psalm until you, Holy Spirit, bring something out of it so I can walk out of this time saying, God spoke to me, right? Just don't move until it happens. Don't leave. You've been asking the Holy Spirit to speak to you. Now's the time at this step, step six. This is the time to hear what the Holy Spirit is speaking to your life today. And now, finally, step seven, finally, pray through the psalm. See, if we just pick up the Bible and we don't do all the previous stuff, we'll just pray the words. I mean, you know, you can, and sometimes I do, but I shouldn't. You can pick up the Bible, and once you learn how to pray the scripture, you can pick up the Bible and pray any scripture. Yep, okay, I'll pray it. All right, I'm done. Don't. Go through the process so when you pray it, there's something meaningful happening. You know, when we say, well, you know, I've been following the Lord, but, you know, I don't, you know, nothing's really changed in my life. Listen, God wants something to change in your life. But you have to desire that. We have to desire this relationship. We have to make this time. And when we're at this point, now we can pray through the psalm, step seven, pray through the psalm. Now you're not just repeating the words, but the Holy Spirit's now impressed on you how this psalm specifically applies to your life today. So now you can allow the psalm, the subject of the psalm, to guide your prayer. This is the goal, is not just to repeat the words of the psalm like a you know, repetitious, you know, they have prayer books, you know, and not just the Catholics too. A lot of Protestant churches go with the prayer book because they don't want to bother the pastor to have a real relationship with Jesus Christ. So they just give him a book and say, just read this prayer on this day. Forget about it, all right? Sorry to all you fellow pastors who read your prayers. Stop it. I don't want you to do it either. I don't want you to just read your prayer out of the Psalms. I want you to pray the subject of the Psalm. You might use the same words, and that's fine, but God wants a heart connection from you according to His Word. So you're allowing His Word to guide your prayer, and you're praying the subject of the Psalm, not just blindly repeating the words. And so that's why all the preparation, so that when you do pray, it's real, you know? You're in a relationship. And the God of the universe is impressing something on you. And you're like, okay, this is cool. You know, this ain't just church. This is a real deal. Now you're in a real conversation with God. Now you're in real communion with God. The prayer book that God ordained has become your prayer book. The prayer book that God wrote by His Holy Spirit and through the authors has become your prayer and worship book. You have arrived at the source. And if you will use that source to guide and direct your relationship with God, it will transform you, period. You cannot be in the presence of God at this level and not be transformed. You can't be. You can't be. You can't be. You will be transformed. I promise you, you will. Because 2 Corinthians 3:18 tells me so. It says, and we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord. You get into this place where spiritually you're in communion with God. You're beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. Look at the last sentence of 2 Corinthians 3:18. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit's job to bring you to this place and then transform you. Listen, I know I say it all the time, and I'm not driving you away. I want you to stay, but church won't transform your life. Jesus Christ will transform your life, and He'll do it through this living Word and the power of the Holy Spirit. There's a supernatural thing, and you get changed through it. God doesn't change, you change. And that's good, all right? It's really, really, really good. That's what praying the Psalms should do to us. As we learn to pray the Psalms, we'll naturally begin to pray all Scripture. It'll just become kind of part of us, so we don't have to go through all seven steps all the time. It just becomes kind of how we live. Like the Daily Discipleship Journal, we pushed that so long and kind of started it again. But you don't have to always go through every single step. It's a training to look at Scripture different. That's what praying the Psalms will do. Train you to look at Scripture different, and I absolutely promise you that if you will set yourself to it, that God, through the power of the Holy Spirit and His living Word, through your relationship with Jesus Christ, will transform your life. Amen? All right, let's pray. Get ready for communion. Lord, that's what we want. Lord, we came to You because we recognized our need to be saved, to be transformed. We came to You, Lord, because we recognized we were sinners, separated from Your presence by our sin, and helpless and hopeless without You. And if you're here today, and that is you today, recognize your place. That in your sin, Ephesians says you are already dead. You are the walking dead. You're already dead in your sin and your trespasses. But Jesus Christ died to make you alive to God. And so right now you can leave dead and enter alive. If that's you today, pray something like this. Lord Jesus, I don't understand most of this, but I understand today I'm lost without You. I'm separated from you by my sin, and your wrath is coming justly. And so, Lord, I pray you would forgive me. Forgive me of my sin. Save me from the wrath that my sin is due. And unite me in a real relationship with you. I surrender my own life to you today. Jesus, come into my life. Fill my life. Save me and transform me. I commit to follow you from this day forward. Please fill me with your Spirit to enable me to do that. And draw me into a real relationship with you. In your name, Jesus, amen.